Today on BRStv, we have the first episode of a two-part series where we do some testing and put an end to the chloramine versus carbon block debate. Hi, I'm Ryan, your host of BRStv, where each week we cover a new topic related to reefing. This week we're going to start a test where we evaluate the chloramine capacity of some carbon blocks popular within our industry. There's an idea out there that standard carbon blocks are effective solutions for treating chloramines. Rather than debate this endlessly, we'd rather just test and compare the results against their cost to identify the most cost-effective solution. The gallon ratings you see in the data sheets for carbon blocks, such as good for 7,000 or 20,000 gallons, are all based off vastly different sets of criteria. The three main elements that change are the flow rate, the on-off cycle, and failure point, all of which will play a large role in how long a block will last in its rating. One of the more common test scenarios is aimed at household use with 1 gallon a minute with 10% on, 90% off, and the failure rate at 50% breakthrough, which really doesn't apply to how the average reefer uses a carbon block or RODI systems. Rather than try and conform to these standards, we elected to do two sets of testing to confirm results in a variety of uses. Both tests are going to test the ability to treat for chloramines and use the BRS Universal carbon block designed specifically to treat for both chlorine and chloramines versus a couple of the water industry's most respected and trusted carbon blocks designed for chlorine with a 5 micron block rated for 6,000 gallons and a 0.6 micron block rated for 20,000 gallons. We'll also throw in a refillable cartridge of catalytic carbon and see how that performs as well. First test is apples to apples at 1 gallon a minute. How many continuous gallons can each block remove at least 80% of the chloramines? We'll stop testing once the last block reaches 20% breakthrough and then make a cost-benefit evaluation. For the second test, we'll use some testing methodology that's closer to how a reefer would use an RODI system and carbon blocks. Performance of carbon is particularly dependent on contact time and flow rates. Most performance data sheets out there are based off 1 gallon per minute, which is much faster than an average 75 gallon per day RODI system produces water. We selected a 1/4 gallon a minute, which is much closer once you consider waste and product water production. Second consideration is the on-off cycle during the test. Carbon more or less regenerates its ability to treat for chlorine and chloramine during downtime. And in most applications, water isn't running continually through it 24/7. NSF testing standards can vary anywhere from 10% on to 90% off, which is a fairly lenient standard to 50% on-off 8-hour cycles, which is the most stringent. What we want to simulate is how the average reefer is going to use it, which is even harder on the block, and fill a container like this one, which holds enough water for a water change and some top-off water. For this test, we selected a very stringent standard of 50% on, 50% off, 12-hour cycles, which at 1/4 gallon an hour will process 180 gallons of water per cycle. At a 3-to-1 waste-to-product water ratio from a typical RO system, this will fill a 45-gallon container, which is fairly typical for an average reefer. We debated a bit when to take the test sample, at the beginning, middle, end of each cycle. Since the NSF takes its sample near the beginning and the average reefer is also likely to take their sample shortly after turning the system on, we elected to take the sample 10 minutes after starting each 12-hour cycle. As to the results, we elected to consider 20% total chlorine or chloramine breakthrough as the failure threshold and stop the test once the last carbon block reaches 20% breakthrough, at which point we'll calculate the most economical and best value solution. The water supply to our building is provided by the city of Minneapolis, and while it fluctuates slightly, the typical chloramine concentrations are near the legal limits for total chlorine of 4 parts per million. For those of you that don't know, to measure for chloramines, you need to perform a test for both free and total chlorine. Typical total chlorine at the BRS warehouse is about 3.5 parts per million, and the average free chlorine is about 0.3, which means we have about 3.2 parts per million chloramines in our water. Rather than perform both tests each day and test for chloramine specifically, we're going to test for total chlorine, since chloramines are making up a vast majority of the total chlorine in our water, and we care about both chlorine and chloramine breakthrough anyways. So based on 3.5 parts per million, we're going to consider 0.7 parts per million the failure point for each filter. To make sure the results are reasonably accurate, we install these flow meters and monitors on each canister to control the flow rate and measure the total volume of water passed through each of the filters. For testing, we're using a Hawk DR900 colorimeter, which I'm confident will give accurate results. We're going to test the same four options, starting with the trusted chlorine blocks, a 5 micron block rated for 6,000 gallons, a 0.6 micron block rated for 20,000 gallons, a refillable cartridge filled with granular catalytic activated carbon, and the BRS Universal block designed specifically to treat for chlorine and chloramines. At 180 gallons a day with particularly long on cycles and near the legal maximum of total chlorine, my expectation is we're going to need to run this test for 2 to 3 weeks. As soon as we have that data, we'll quickly put together a results video and share the findings with you. Beauty of this test is with some 50 cent test strips, you can do something similar for yourself on your own water supply. If you have any guesses on how long each filter is going to last, share them in the comments area down below. If you haven't already, make sure to hit that subscribe button. You won't want to miss episode 2 of this series where we share the results. If you're really interested, check out our Facebook page where we might just release some of the results a bit early. See you next week with another episode of BRStv.